Fire up that cigar. It's the Stogie Geek Show. Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 17 of the Stogie Geek Show. This is the Oliva Serie V Maduro Especial Special Edition Especial Serie episode 17. I'm your host, Paul Asadorian, and very excited about this show. We're going to smoke four different cigars and drink two different kinds of rum just in an attempt to confuse ourselves and our viewers slash listeners. I am joined by a very astute group of individuals who have joined me to drink and smoke. And funny part is, it wasn't too hard to find people who wanted to show up on a Friday night and drink and smoke.
Surprise, surprise.
Surprise, surprise. So Tim is here with us.
Hello.
Welcome, Tim.
How's everybody doing?
Mr. Tim Margarini to the show. Welcome, my friend. How are you doing tonight?
All right, man. Feeling better after a week of upper respiratory infection. So
yes,
I'm ready to smoke.
You're ready to smoke.
I had some downtime. My palate's fresh.
And you are already smoking. That's very nice. It's very nice. Let's see. I'll go around the room here. Mark Jr. is here.
Well, hello.
Welcome, Mark Jr. It was a last-minute addition. We didn't think he could make it. And then we finally... Well, we suck at scheduling, so Mark's here.
There's some confusion.
Mark's here is good. Mr. Ben C. Ben C. is here. Welcome, Ben.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Yes. And, of course, from the Skype lines, Ben from Nice Tight Ash is here. Welcome, Ben.
Thank you. Appreciate it being back.
Yes. Back on the show for a second appearance.
I think anytime,
just
Ben.
Second, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Second anytime. Appearance.
Yep.
Welcome. Thank you for joining us and helping us smoke these fabulous cigars. So again, we are all smoking. Well, I'm working on finding a lighter for mine and all that stuff. Tim, why don't we, so I'll go through. So we're smoking the 4 years that we could get a hold of the Oliva Serie V Maduro Especial.
Yes. Okay.
So from here on in, we're just going to reference them by year because I'm tired of already of saying Oliva Serie
That's
V
a mouthful.
Maduro Especial. So these are the special cigars released every November, Tim, you said?
It's roughly in November. The way I understood it is a lot of confusion on the web about these smokes.
Yes.
A lot of misinformation. Is there was only been 4 years to date, and somebody can correct me if they know something else, but I believe...
I thought there was a 2007.
The 2007 was a limited edition.
Okay.
But from what I read, it wasn't designated as a Maduro Especial.
I got you.
I could be wrong about that.
I got you.
So we have the 2008, the 2009, the 2010, and the 2011 from last November. Ben C.
Ben C.,
thank you. Mark Jr., you guys got the 2008?
Indeed, sir.
All right.
Yes. So Ben C. and Mark Jr. are smoking the 2008. Ben from Nice Head Ash is smoking the 2009. Have you lit that one up yet, Ben?
No, I'm about to do it right now, as a matter of fact.
Excellent. Excellent.
Do you want to cover some of the differences before we get too far in?
Yeah, well, so we'll talk about what each of us is smoking since we're already down that path. I'm smoking the 2011. Tim, like you said, 2010.
2010, yep.
2010. 2011 is me. So let's talk about each one of these fine cigars. If you look in the show notes for this episode, we list out all four of them in the magic of HTML that I put
together. You'll see Paul's
I'm like wicked awesome with
HTML ninja skills. It's so 1999.
Yes, it was very 1999. So 2008, the origin of all of these cigars is Nicaragua.
Yes,
Oliva being a Nicaragua-based company.
Yep.
And the wrapper on the 2008 is a Connecticut broadleaf wrapper.
Correct.
The binder and filler are Nicaraguan, the filler being a Jalapa Valley Ligero.
Now, from what I read, is it is a slight variation of the filler from the regular Serie V.
Good information, information. The strength is medium full. I'd say medium full.
Yeah.
I mean, I smoked 8, 9, and 10, and 11 I'm smoking right now. So I would agree they're all about medium full.
Yeah.
Would you guys
concur? Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. The Vitola for the 2008 is a torpedo, and it is a 6.5 by 52.
Are we sure?
Now, there is some conflicting information. So here's what I did. I went to our local cigar store, and I want to thank them for providing us with these smokes.
We're very blessed to have a shop that would have these in stock.
Some were gifted, some were sold to us at a discounted rate so that we could do them on the show. And to have access to ones going all the way back to 2008 is something special in and of itself.
Yes.
So what I did today, because I was confused after smoking them during the week and Tim and I talking about what has what wrapper, what has what size.
You were frustrated, to be honest, but
yeah,
I could see why.
Well, and I realized that I didn't have a 2011, so I had to go to the store anyway. So what I did was I went to the store, and Stogie Santa brought out all four boxes. And I personally inspected each box, and I pulled an 8, 9, 10, and 11, one from each box. And I bought them, and we labeled them, so there would be no confusion. Because they're all, I mean, the 2011's a Toro, which we'll get to, but so you kind of know what that one is.
Yeah.
But the 8, 9, and 10 are similar sizes.
They're all torpedoes.
I've got 6.5 by 52 for the 2008.
That's what I have.
Yeah. Now, some Oliva reps and other websites will tell you that it's not, that it is the shorter one. I think they're just as confused as we were,
yeah,
to be honest with you. And it is very confusing. Now, so these are about 3.5 years old, the 2008s. They were originally $6.75 sold in boxes of 10.
Yes.
So I'm not sure what the retail price was that we paid here in Rhode Island.
I want to say it was around $8, which is...
Yeah, it was probably around $8.
It's
$8.
A good smoke for $8.
Yeah, it's a fantastic smoke for $8, yeah. I'd say the value is high value as far as what you get for the price.
Absolutely.
Mark and Ben C., you guys have lit up your 2008s. What do you guys think so far?
It's a very, very enjoyable smoke. The burn and construction have been impeccable so far. They've been holding the ash until it falls in my lap.
So you got, the first ash of the night.
Yeah, I did.
Excellent. All right.
It's got that broadleaf Maduro wrapper taste. It's, you know, nice and rich, but it's got that spicy Nicaraguan filler taste as well. It's nice balance, nice.
Yeah, no, I think from the age, I got a subtle, more of a subtle spice. Well, in the very beginning, I did get a lot of spice.
It's mellowed out, but it's still staying on my lips. So,
Ben, what do you think of it so far? Ben C., right. I should say. Ben C.
Yep, so I agree with Mark Jr. Construction's really good. I noted that I've cut the cap 3 times, and it still is in perfect condition, like it didn't break off or
nice.
Anything.
Nicely done.
So I think that very good construction. I get kind of a cocoa off of it. I do get a little bit of spice at the beginning, but at this point, it's starting to mellow out a little bit. So
now you're both through just about the first third. And I was reading Tim's review and another review, maybe from Half Wheel, and kind of after I smoked it to see. I tried not to taint my perception of it. But I got like this flavor that I couldn't quite place, and I called it a toasty flavor. And then Tim and Half Wheel both described it as roasted nuts. And I think that was spot on. That was dead on.
Nice.
The first third of that cigar, I got that really awesome roasted nuts flavor. And that was by far my most favorite part of the cigar.
I could agree with that. After having gotten this far into it,
You do get it. I do get that hint of cocoa as well. But that first third was very, the more prominent flavor for me was roasted nuts, which I really liked.
I reviewed these back in October, November. I compared 2009 and the 2008, I believe.
Correct. Yep. Okay. Correct. So going in order now, we'll move to 2009. They changed the wrapper to a Habano seed Nicaraguan. And is a Nicaraguan binder and filler. Filler is from the Jalapa Valley Lajero medium full torpedo. This one's a 6x52, so it's a slightly shorter.
Yep.
Again, about 2.5 years of age. $9 a piece is the MSRP, and all of these are sold in boxes of 10.
Yep.
So Ben, how you doing with the 2009? And you've probably smoked these before, correct?
Yeah, this is one of my favorite Maduros of all time. Ooh. Every time these come out, I at least buy one box, and that's why I have pretty much every year this has came out. This one is definitely different from the other ones. The other ones, I get that nice cocoa flavor, where on this one, it's got that cocoa flavor, but it's more of a bitter chocolate. It's more subdued than on the other ones, where this one's got more spice to it. Also, it has a nice espresso note to it that's right in the beginning, which seems to develop a little bit further on. But smoking perfect.
I agree with your assessment. I definitely got more spice from that cigar, and I believe that to be because the wrapper is Nicaraguan. I think you get a little more spice from it because they switched out the wrapper. I also got a much nicer espresso flavor as you described. Definitely that stick would pair nicely with coffee. I did get a much more of a cocoa espresso flavor from the 2009. I found them to be two totally different cigars.
It is two totally different cigars.
Yes, absolutely.
It's funny that you say coffee, because that is one of my go-to Maduros with coffee right there. Mm-hmm. As I really enjoyed that stick with coffee. So
I got a hint of the bitter, kind of bitter coffee flavor too, but I would say that wasn't in the forefront. That for the most part, it was very smooth.
Not at all.
And that's probably the age. Which kind of brings us to the 2010, which Tim is smoking. Again, Origin Nicaragua on all these cigars. They changed the wrapper out again.
Yes, they did.
This wrapper on the 2010 is a Mexican San Andreas Maduro wrapper.
Yes, it is.
It's a totally different wrapper on this cigar. This is a slightly, everything else is the same, medium full, filler is Nicaraguan. It's a torpedo, and the size is 6x54.
Slightly larger
ring gauge. Yes, yeah. Not as well aged, obviously, because it came out in 2010. Same price, comes in boxes of 10. Tim, what do you think of the 2010?
Well, first let me say that it's smoking fantastic now. I think it's smoking better than it was a year and a half ago. Mm. A year and a half ago was May. Mm-hmm. But now, wow. I still get a lot of cocoa coffee off of it, but the wrapper definitely adds something different. It's almost a grittiness to it. I don't know if that's the best way to describe it. And there's some syrupiness on the finish. That's the best way I guess I could describe it. A sweetness, but it's not a sugary sweetness.
I think you're right.
It's a thick sweetness.
I think the I got similar properties between 2009 and 2010, but I think you're right. The finish on your palate is definitely
different.
In 2010 versus the 2009.
And I've gotten similar finishes from the same wrapper on different cigars.
Interesting.
Mexican wrapper. So.
Yeah, I got a very much bitter espresso cocoa flavor in the 2010, and I thought that paired very well with coffee.
Yeah. It's going well with this rum, but we'll get to that in a minute.
Yeah, I really liked the 2010, the flavor profile, a lot.
Okay.
It's not as aged, so it lacked, I thought, a little bit of balance from the other ones. Mm-hmm. And I thought that the bitterness was a little more in the forefront of the flavor profile. It didn't prevent me from enjoying it with a cup of coffee. I think in another year or two, it's going to be equally as amazing.
It's interesting you say that, because I remember them being a lot more bitter when they were first released. So I think it's toned down a little bit. But that's just me. I'm enjoying it. This is the one I chose because it has been a while since I smoked one.
Yeah.
I'm very familiar with the 2008, 2009.
Yeah, I figured you reviewed those. So
I reviewed those. I have them still in my humidor. They're favorites of mine. So this is the one I really wanted to smoke.
Yeah. So the next one is the 2011, which I'm smoking. This, is the Mexican San Andreas Maduro wrapper. This is a completely different Vitola. This is a Toro size. And it is a 6x50, about 6 months of age, and again, the same price. And I tell you what, I really like it. Very much the similar characteristics of 2010. Mm-hmm. Not as spicy, I find, as the 2010. I thought, from when I first lit this up, I'm just a little of the ways through it right now. I'm holding up for the camera. That the spice is a little subdued. There was a very smooth smoke from the beginning, so.
Now, do you think that's the format that it's in, or do you think there's something changed in the blend? Or
I think a lot of it has to do with format.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
I guess some nice flavors from it. Again, that cocoa, a little bit of bitter espresso. Ben, what's your assessment on some of the other Maduro Especials? You say you buy a box every time they come out, so I'm curious to hear your thoughts on each of these. Oh, do we lose Ben's audio?
Do we lose Ben?
He's still there. I can see him. I just can't hear him.
Sorry about that.
No, no worries. No worries.
No, I was saying was when I was muted. I actually kind of liked the went with the Toro better than the torpedo because the torpedo. I never really had a severe issue with any torpedoes, but I did notice a lot of them had a little bit more tighter draw than I like.
Yeah.
Nothing that I would you know throw the cigar away for, but you just work through it. The Toros they've changed to. I haven't had a single burn problem or draw problem or nothing. They were all you just spot on every one of them. Now the flavor to me, I like the San Andreas wrapper. I do like it, but I prefer the original wrappers. The original wrappers because to me they had more of a what I consider my favorite Maduro profile, which is a coffee, you know, sweet cocoa note to them.
Yep, yep.
I just prefer that more than the San what I get off the San Andreas off this or these this particular San Andreas blend. But I still enjoy both of them. But I prefer really, I think the 2008 is probably my favorite out of all of them.
Mm. Now, curious, Paul, Ben yes. from Nice Tight Ash, what do you think of the finish of the 2011? Because my junior and I were talking earlier about the finish.
Yeah, it's got a very different finish from all the others. I can't quite place it.
Okay,
it's definitely not as long as of a finish. It's definitely a shorter finish. The flavor doesn't stay on my palate as long as some of the other ones that I smoked. I'm not sure. Is that an age thing? I don't know.
I'm sure. Just curious to get everybody's thoughts. Mm. Ben, do you have any thoughts on that from your memory?
No, I was thinking that. I was thinking the same thing. It didn't have a long of a finish on it either. And to me, the notes kind of all get a little bit subdued at the end. Like, there's nothing that's, you know, more dominant than the other either. It kind of smooths out, but it does kind of get muted down a little bit. But which is kind of wondering about how the ageability will be of the cigar, because if it does that now, I'm thinking these are the ones you should smoke now.
Yeah,
try not to wait too long.
Yeah. Now, speaking of the finish, the 2008s, I definitely get a nice, sweet flavor that's left on my palate from the 2008s.
Yeah, absolutely.
I know you guys are experiencing it's pretty intense. I mean, yeah.
And it stays with you for a while. It's a long finish.
Yeah.
That's my favorite of all of them. Definitely.
Yeah, I would have to say, I mean, I think they're all very different cigars in their own right. But the 2008 has that kind of roasted nuts, almost buttery kind of finish to it, which I really enjoyed a lot.
Yeah, I would agree. So far in the past, since last Thursday, I've smoked the 09, the 08 to 09, mm-hmm. and then last night I smoked a 2011 Toro. I would agree with you that they're all different, but I would be hard pressed to pick a favorite between the 09 and the 08.
It's tough.
I really like both of them.
I do too, yeah.
They're really great. That finish on the Toro was a little weird to me.
I agree with Mach Jr. on it. I wasn't a fan of the finish of the Toro. That's why I asked.
Yeah.
I like the flavors. I like the format.
I agree that
it draws and burns better than most of the torpedoes.
Well, a torpedo now, it's kind of a strange format. I mean, because you're taking a larger ring gauge, you're going to a smaller ring gauge. Inevitably, I think that may be the cause of some of the draw problems with them, right?
Well, it's a narrower opening, right?
Yeah. So that definitely changes the flavor profile. Also, I think it causes them to burn a little hotter as well.
Okay.
Because that may be because of just your natural tendency to want to pull harder and draw more from them, which I definitely find myself doing with the torpedo format, and I don't find myself doing that with the Toro format. So
it's a good point. Very good point.
I do want to say that with the flavors of all these cigars, to me, coffee is the perfect pairing drink with this.
Yeah. I'm going to go with Tim, though. This rum is going extremely
going fantastic,
well.
Fantastic, yeah.
So, Ben, do you have any favorites to pair with these cigars?
Well, yeah. Pretty much, I pair everything with either bourbon or coffee. This one, you're right. I like the coffee pairing better. But right now, what I'm pairing it with is some Four Roses single barrel, and it's going pretty well with that.
Nice.
And also, I just kind of finished off my first little bit of that.
Sure.
And I'm moving on now to a Sweetwater Georgia Brown Ale to see how that pairs. It's a little bit more bitter.
Mm-hmm.
See how that goes with the bitter espresso notes in this cigar itself.
Yeah. Now, do you pair them with bourbon in the morning, or is that more like a coffee thing in the morning, or do you put a little bourbon in your coffee in the morning?
Of course.
Yeah, absolutely.
Irish Southern boy, got to put a little bit of bourbon and Irish whiskey in your coffee.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Awesome.
So just to talk about what we've been pairing with, you'll see in the show notes we're drinking two types of rum on the show tonight, an Abuelo, Ron Abuelo 7-year, and an Abuelo 12-year.
Which we have yet to crack.
We have not. Yeah, we're drinking the 7-year right now. It's really good. It's around $24 a bottle.
It's a steal.
For the 7-year. Yeah. It's a great rum. Abuelo means grandfather in Spanish.
Indeed.
We checked with our linguists that we have here as consultants on the Stogie Geek Show.
Thank you, Mark Jr.
Ronnie Grandfather.
Yeah, Ronnie Grandfather. We're drinking Ronnie Grandfather 7-year over here. And it is pairing very well with the cigar. I do... coffee probably be my first choice, and I think, you know, good rum or bourbon is... and I like that in a cigar. I like having versatility.
Yep.
It causes, you know, it's almost... It allows you to smoke more of them, right? You can
smoke
them with...
I would not pair any of these with scotch, frankly. I can't imagine it.
But. Yeah, scotch may overpower some of the subtle flavors that we pick up on these smokes. So, excellent, excellent. Just a little more about these cigars, and this comes from the manufacturer. The Serie V Maduro is a complex blend of Nicaraguan long filler tobaccos, blended with specially fermented Jalapa Valley Lajero and finished with a high-priming Habano sun-grown wrapper, which would be... That was probably referring to the 2011 release, since that's the one that had the Habano wrapper.
That's 2009, actually, I believe.
2009, I'm sorry. Yes, you're correct. Let's see. So we talked about there was a 2007 limited version, which I have never smoked. Has anyone smoked the 2007 limited version?
Never seen it.
Nope.
No.
Okay. Let's see. The 2009 release received the number 5 spot in Cigar Aficionado's Best of 2009. And we'll all see how these are progressing. You know, certainly the first third. I find the first third of a cigar... on ones that have been aged more than a year or two, I find that to be the best part. Like, usually when you've got a cigar that's got a good amount of age on it, those first flavors, when you first light it up, you don't get anything. Usually
most
you don't
of
get
the
anything.
Time,
most
yeah.
of the time,
there's
you
been
get,
some exceptions.
Yeah,
but
you get some great flavors from that first third. So, Abuelo 7's going good. We're going to switch to the 12. We'll talk about some of our stogies for the week. Tim, do you want to start us off?
Yeah, sure. Have a bit of a shorter list from that nasty sinus infection I had. But I started out with the Juan Lopez Selection number 1. Really smooth. Thank you, Mark Jr., for gifting me this.
Oh, no problem.
I enjoyed it. Smooth, easy to smoke Cuban. I couldn't detect a lot of flavors. I just knew I enjoyed it. You know, one of those smokes that you kind of lose yourself in just sitting on the back deck at night. There's definitely some citrus notes in the first half, a little more spice in the second. Really good and enjoyable. I would revisit, no doubt. So,
you're welcome. I love them. I love them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, Ben, from Nice Tide Ash, do you have any thoughts on that cigar, or have you smoked anything recently, maybe from Cuba, that you particularly enjoyed?
Well, it's funny you mention that. This morning I smoked a 2005... Ramon Aliones specially selected.
Ooh. Rock on, man.
Yeah, I got a couple of those.
Yes, he does.
Very nice. Yes.
That cigar is just unbelievable. It's for the price, it's just incredible how good that cigar is. And the thing is, with that cigar, you don't have to age it that long for it to be spectacular.
It's funny you say that because there might be a 2011 in your mailbox tomorrow, so you can compare.
There you go.
Wow. Awesome.
Now, speaking of the Ramon Aliones, I smoked one today as well. This one was from 2011. It's not my favorite Cuban flavor profile cigar, but I do really like having a box of them because it's a nice change of pace Cuban for me. To me, the flavors that it presents are different from a lot of the other Cuban cigars out there.
Very different.
Yeah.
And you hate them, and you're going to sell them all to me.
Yeah, no, I definitely don't hate them. I definitely enjoy smoking them a lot. I appreciate the flavors. again, I like it because it's a good change of pace cigar for me. I tend to smoke ones with a more traditional, I think, Cuban flavor profile than the Ramon Eliones. I think for the price, you can't go wrong with a box of these in your humidor. Now, would I keep two boxes, you know, one to age, one to smoke? My flavor profile, maybe not. There were definitely other Cubans I would do that with, but they're definitely a stand-up cigar, good price, and good flavors again.
Paul, you're wrong.
My flavor profile, I would keep five if I had the room.
Really?
Yeah. I
see,
agree.
I find that you guys enjoy that cigar much more than I do.
I say the Oasis, man.
Really?
All across the desert. I almost pulled the trigger on another box this week, and I stopped myself only because of the financial. But it's a steal for the price.
It is a good price.
Yeah.
I don't disagree
with those
there.
And the Juan Lopez are something that I would have multiple boxes of because I have yet to have a bad one. They're one of the more consistent Cuban brands that I've gotten.
I do have to say, though, the one you gifted me from 2005, that was a lot more spectacular.
They're
7 years old at that point, right? So they do age really well. Okay.
What else do you have in your list?
I've got, this is the first one. We haven't even talked about anything on my list yet. Well, how far into this? This is going to be a long show. Bear with us out there.
We're having a good time, man.
We are.
Good.
You know, I mean, we're drinking, smoking. It's all good. Hoyo de Monterrey. How do you say this, Mark Jr.? De Dois?
I was corrected by Ben.
Oh.
De Dieu.
What Ben C said. De Dieu?
He is wearing wearing a beret, so I'm going to say.
He is. He looks French over there with the beret. I wish we could get his camera on him.
Damn French.
So, Ben, say it again for us.
De Dieu.
Ah, yes. One of those. This one was from 1995?
You have 98.
No,
98, yeah.
This is the band that came on. I'm going to pull it out of the ashtray and hold it up for everyone.
That's awesome. My glorious handwriting, Phyllis.
Yes, that is Mark Jr.'s glorious handwriting on there. I like these bands. So I smoked this, and it was not aged out. It burn and construction were spot on, and the flavors I describe as pure heaven. This is definitely a crawl across the desert. Well, I mean, a 14-year-old vintage Cuban, right? I mean...
It could be hit or miss, though.
It could be. And I have to tell you, for one that's 14 years old, this has to be probably my favorite. I mean, it just poured flavors. It was nothing but flavor. When you did a retrohale on it, there was absolutely you could retrohale every puff on this and be totally fine, not have any harshness. It was that good. I was just enjoying the flavors tremendously.
Nice.
It was kind of funny. As I was smoking it, my... contractor that's installing a fence hit one of the sprinkler lines. And I was like, whatever.
Don't worry about it. It's all good.
It's all good. I'm like puffing. I'm like, whatever.
You're going to give me 10% discount now, right?
Yeah. It was all it was so, so good. So
that's a special cigar right there.
Yes.
Have you had that, Ben?
No. I've tried to steal them. I mean, ask buddies for one that I know got them that live near me.
Yeah. How's that working out?
It's just not too good. Yeah. It's I mean, everybody that I know that's had one, it's almost been like a religious experience. So it's definitely on my short list.
It means
of God.
Yep.
I would agree with that.
That makes sense.
I split a box with Stogie Santa of some newer ones that were box dated 2011. Okay. They are really good as well.
Excellent.
Yeah. They're one of my favorite Cubans, I think.
Excellent.
Yes. And then, of course, this week I did smoke the 08, 09, and 10 as well, which we talked about it at length already. We'll come back to those.
We'll revisit.
Yeah, we'll revisit. I did smoke another one here on my list, the Quesada Selección España.
Great smoke.
There's just one, and this was the short Robusto or Petit Robusto. I really like this, and I'm going to disagree with you guys again on this one. I like that format better than the Corona.
Well,
just putting that out there.
Stogie Santa has gone back and forth. One time he said that short Robusto was his favorite. The next time was the Corona. So, you know, I don't think you're alone there. I don't think he can even decide.
Me either.
I can.
Okay.
I like the Corona better.
Yeah, Mark Jr. favors the Corona. I've smoked both, and I favor the short Robusto hands down. I think it's a floral flavor that I get from them. A subtle spice, very, very smooth, and box-worthy, in my opinion.
NTA Ben, what do you say?
Oh, well, it's one of my favorite cigars of all time. It's almost an Oasis cigar. Now, and I've had all three of them, all three sizes, and I can't decide which one I love the best. But luckily, I was able to get my hands on a box of the Coronas. So
yeah, I saw that box right, right before it was shipped. It almost grabbed it.
Uh-huh. I'm glad I was quick on that one. But so I guess you could say that's my favorite, I guess, with the Corona.
Okay. How does everyone think this cigar is going to age?
Oh, phenomenally.
Fantastic. Yeah, very well.
It's going to be a no-brainer. It's going to age well.
Yeah. Rhode Island, Ben, do you have an opinion?
Yeah, I think I've only smoked the I smoked the smaller of the two. Which one is that?
There's a Robusto, a short Robusto, and the Corona.
I smoked the short Robusto.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree. I think with age they'll get phenomenally better. I'm gonna make a prediction. I think you're gonna get some sweetness out of it when it ages. I think you'll get some sweetness. It's just a random prediction, but that's what I think.
Yeah, I didn't get any sweetness right now out of it.
What's some cigars, they come out and they're like the factory press, the Florida Minicana.
Yeah, yeah, I
now
agree.
It's sweet till the day is
long. Yeah, I think floral and sweetness are two separate things. I think you're absolutely correct, because sweetness didn't come to mind. It was definitely floral. And the Robusto is a 5x50. I'm not sure what the short Robusto is. This is an Araparaca from Ecuador wrapper, Dominican binder, and the filler is Dominican and Nicaraguan. And this was for the Spanish market? Is that what the story behind
this? The way I understand it, it was originally released for the Spanish market to compete with Habanos over mm-hmm. there. It gained so much popularity that they did release it to a certain amount of
retailers
in this country. We just happened to be lucky enough to be near one. So
nice.
Correct me if I'm wrong, anybody, if I'm wrong on that.
No, that's the way I heard it as well.
Yeah, same with me.
All right, on to my list.
Go ahead,
Podicus. Let's see if I can pronounce this. Lusitanus, is that correct?
Lusitanus.
Yeah.
gifted to me by Bach Jr. during the last episode of the podcast. Double Corona.
I'm giving away too many cigars, I think.
Yeah,
I think that's what's going on.
That's right. I do. When you ask me for the laptop, it's yours, dude. Don't worry about it. I'll set it up for you. It's yours. I actually smoked two of these in the last week. One was gifted to me by Bach Jr. Another one I got in a trade. Same experience with both. First, third was a bit tight but manageable. It opened up. It started out with some cedar. Some grassy hay notes, a little Cuban trang. I did get some mild pepper. Second half brought some toastiness. An enjoyable gift, but not something I would go out of my way for personally. I do have one left, and I'm going to revisit, but it didn't wow me.
Was this the one from 2005?
The one that Mark Jr. gave me, yes.
That's the one you smoked or no?
I smoked more than one. Oh. That was one of the ones I smoked.
Okay.
The one from 2005 was certainly better than the newer ones I had. I believe the newer ones I got in a trade were about 2 years old.
Had no burn and draw constructions?
First third was tight.
Okay.
On both of them, yeah. I was hoping it was just the first stick, but no, the one I smoked today, same experience.
So I smoked the one from 2005 that Mark Jr. also gifted me. Thank you, Mark Jr. And thanks to this stick, I stayed warm on Sunday while Tim and I were smoking outdoors in a cigar event here in Rhode Island when it was very cold, damp, and rainy, put on by Mr. J. Havana's Smoke Shop, actually. And to me, this stick poured flavors from the time I lit it up to the time I burned my fingers on it. Well over an hour and a half of just pure bliss, smooth, earth and wood flavors, the classic Cuban profile. Great burn and construction. To me, they're box worthy.
Excellent.
I didn't get any pepper off the one from 2005.
That's the one I did get some pepper off of. But
yeah, I didn't get that. But I'd have to smoke another one to see if I get pepper off that.
Yeah, like I said, I got one left. So nice. He's looking at Mark Jr. over there.
I got a few more.
Maybe we can hook up on some
NTA
trades.
Ben, have you had this smoke?
No, I haven't.
You will. It's in the mail.
Look at that.
I love my
I included it in the box I sent you, so
cool.
But yeah, it was so good that I actually went through and smoked a lot of my larger sized Cuban cigars.
Yeah.
It's the best one I've had so far. I've had the Hoyo de Monterey double Corona. I've had the Boulevard double Corona. Boulevard did a regional release, Alemania. That was a double Corona as well.
I have to agree with you, though. It was one of the better Habano double Coronas I've
ever think it's
had.
The best one I've had so far.
I've had a lot of construction issues with double Coronas in the past. But
yeah, the larger
by rule,
size,
almost. Yeah. Punch double Corona. I got the two that I've had were unsmokable. You know, like the first.
You know, it's funny you say that though. Stogie Santa, we smoked it on the. I smoked it on the show. Gave me a punch double Corona from 2006.
Yes, I remember that.
And it smoked beautifully, and as a result, it is still my favorite.
Very nice
large Cuban cigar. And I mean, it could have been just that one was.
But that's
a
Cuban cigar for you, though.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
Know,
exactly.
I've had only two of them, and I've been kind of put off by the fact that the two of them weren't that good. But you say they're great, so I'd give it another shot.
Having said that, after Stogie Santa gifted me that one, I bought a box of the Punch Double Coronas, and I've had a lot of construction issues with the two or three I've smoked from that box.
I haven't had a problem. I have had two, the older ones. I've still got one left from the late 90s, and it's they smoked really good.
I also have one left from 98, and it's kind of...
A Punch Double Coronas?
Yeah. I mean, I'll smoke it. I'll try it. But the first, I had three of them. I got them in a trade. The first two were.
It's kind of the name of the game, though. I mean, it happens. So, all right, moving on.
Moving on. Padron Ambassador. This was a vintage cigar. I'm not quite sure how old it was, but it was pretty old. To be honest, I wasn't really overly impressed with this size. I mean, it had the nice cocoa flavors that I'd expect from an aged Padron regular series. Some earth flavors. It just didn't deliver a really outstanding overall smoking experience. It wasn't bad by any stretch of the imagination, but I guess I was comparing it to the Padron. Was it the 4,000 that's the Torpedo?
It's either 4 or 5. I can't remember which.
Yeah.
Do you know?
I think it's 4.
Yeah.
I think it's 4.
The Torpedo, in my opinion, was a lot better and presented that earth and cocoa flavors in a much better fashion than this particular size. I think some dry boxing might have helped, this stick may have just been a little off, but again, the Torpedo is still my favorite size in that particular blend. Now, having said that, I did pick up a box of the Robustos on auction. So.
Nice. Yeah. Those are the 2000s.
Yeah, the 2000s.
And those are awesome.
Those are great.
Those are awesome.
I took one out of the cellophane, and I gave the sniff test, and I was, yes.
You know what, man? I still say that's the... best Nicaraguan Puro Fund of $5 right there. It's a solid smoke.
Oh, there's no doubt about it.
Yeah,
I agree.
There's no doubt about it. They're good out of the box. They're good a couple years later. They're just good.
You know, speaking of which, I actually tried the Padron Londres Maduro, which is the Corona, the smallest of that whole series. Retails for $3.75. It's not the most attractive Padron you're ever going to find, but I'll tell you what, man, I would buy a box of these hands down, set them aside for a couple of years. They're smoking great now, but I give them a couple of years and they'd be fantastic.
You got it. Yeah, these are wrong. Obviously all Nicaraguan Puros. The one I smoked was 6.8 by 42, and they're medium to full. Average retail, $3.58 was the one that I smoked. So they are very reasonably priced.
Yes, they are.
And good ones to
And I'll tell you
age.
What, the construction is usually dead on them. I mean, I've had very few I've had construction issues with.
Go ahead, Ben.
Go ahead, Ben. What's that?
Rhode Island, Ben.
Well, no, I agree. Like, the Padron 3000, I think after 2 years, is a phenomenal cigar. I think the age really sets it.
It'll smooth it out, yeah.
But I think the Padron regular line, even the Anniversarios, like, the cap is always an issue. Like the cap doesn't seem to be as well constructed as some other cigars, but
interesting.
That's like it's a Padron, so I mean it's got a bad cap. It's not you deal with it exactly.
So the how's everyone's Oliva Serie V Maduro Especials doing? I'll go around the room in order, and we'll do the Skype. Mr. Ben, nice tight ash. Ben, we'll do Ben last. So I'll start with Tim.
2010, smoking good. Just had a relight, but that's only because I've been talking so much. I did clip a little bit more off the cap.
Yep.
Because I did find the draw a little bit too tight for my liking. Same grape flavors. I'm just starting the last third now. So
Nice.
Switched over the Ron Abuelo 12-year.
Abuelo. You switched over to the 12-year.
I did.
What do you think of the difference?
A lot smoother.
Really?
Not as much bite.
Yeah.
Still pairs perfectly with the smoke.
Yeah, I find the flavors to be very similar between the 7 and the 12. I had a glass of the 12 last night just to try it.
Yep.
And I definitely agree with your assessment. Same great flavors, just smoother.
Do you need a pour?
In a moment, yes, okay. I will. By the time we go around, yes, I will.
Okay.
Rhode Island Ben, you have the microphone. You're up next, my friend. How is your 2008 doing?
It's very good flavor-wise. I am having a little bit of construction issue, but I did smoke the 2008 with Mark Jr. last week, and I had the same issue. Don't know if I'm lighting it improperly, but...
it's definitely user error.
Yeah, user error.
Like we're saying, computers,
you want
error.
To light the head, not the,
yeah. Yeah, not the foot.
But no, it is a great cigar. It's getting smoother as it's going down. So I've gotten basically through 2/3 of it, and I got a little bit of a spice in the beginning, but now that's completely gone.
Yep. Mark Jr.
Yeah, I have the 2008 as well, and I agree with that assessment that the spice is almost entirely gone at this point, but it's still very enjoyable. Oddly enough, I had the burn just went crooked on me.
Yeah.
This far. You know, it was razor
that
sharp.
That was razor sharp.
It was razor
point.
Sharp
yeah.
until that point, and it literally just went crooked on me.
I agree. I found with the 2008, I had to do some more touch-up, some more relighting. And as I progressed through the years, I found I had to do less touching up. And from the 2009, I needed some touch-ups. When I got to 2010, I didn't have to touch it up. This 2011, I have not had to touch up at all.
It's burning perfectly.
It's burning perfectly. Yep. It's smoking great. The flavors are awesome. I'm getting a hint of coffee espresso flavor with some subtle spice that pretty much progresses throughout the cigar. Not a lot of change-ups in this one.
No,
but
not at all.
Extremely enjoyable. Extremely enjoyable. And Ben, how are we doing over there? You've got the 2009.
Yeah, this thing is... Mine is burning really, really well. The flavors... They've actually gotten more buttery. It's really now... I'm getting that cocoa sweetness, but it's really subdued a lot now. It's just in the background. But it's really got a nice butteriness to it. With that good strong espresso coffee on it, it's spectacular. I love this one.
Yeah,
agree 100%.
Agree. Moving on to the list, really quickly, Por La Raniaga Monte Carlo. Great smoke. They can be bitter if they're not aged. Make sure you age them. When you do age them, I get a hint of like an orange peel, orange
citrusy
yeah. orange soda, orange cream soda type flavor from them. So buy a box. They're cheap. They're about $100 for a box of 25.
Yep. What size is that again?
Go for it.
Petite.
It is a it's like a 6x38 or 36 or something like that. Yeah, it's very skinny. EP Carrillo Edición Inaugural 2009. This stick is just absolutely amazing. It did. I've been smoking these consistently, I believe, since they first came out, and they just keep getting better or changing. I don't know if they got better or different, but they're just awesome, creamy smoke, full of flavor, nice citrus sweetness. I'm glad I bought a box just to age, and I have some to smoke. This is a 5 & 3. It's by 52. It's an Ecuadorian Habano wrapper. With a Dominican Nicaraguan binder and a Dominican Nicaraguan filler, they retailed for an MSRP of $13 a stick. And I guess you should have already bought a box of these because they're just awesome. Awesome.
Good luck finding them if you have not, unfortunately.
Yes, 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 yes.
I have a box as well. I have a box as well. It's one of my, I don't know, top something cigars. They're just phenomenal.
Nice. Yeah,
phenomenal.
I agree.
The opportunity presented itself a couple months ago, and I couldn't turn it down.
Nice to ask, Ben. Have you smoked this particular cigar before?
Yes, and I do not like it at all.
I'm glad I'm not the only one, man.
No.
Really? You don't like it?
I didn't like the 2009, no. not
because well, I had them when they first came out, and I really did not like it. It's actually the only EP Korea that I don't absolutely love. The rest of them, I think, are just phenomenal. They're amazing. That one was a huge misfire for me. But
really?
Everybody is saying they're smoking awesome now.
Yeah, I need to revisit.
I have one left in my humidor, so
I'm not sure. If you didn't like them when they first came out, you might not like them now. So you should send them to me. I'll give you my address after the show.
You'll have packages coming soon.
I wouldn't call it medium full. I would definitely call it a medium strength cigar. Yeah, and I think that's maybe what turns some people off to it. Is it's not a very strong cigar at all.
So, Ben? Well, for me, it's not so much the body of it, because I really don't care if it's mild, medium, or full, as long as it's got great flavor. But to me, the flavors just was off for me. It's one of those things that just I don't like it, and other people do. It's just that's cigars.
To each his own.
That's right. Everyone's got their opinion. That's interesting that we have different takes on that cigar. Now, Rhode Island Ben. You've got the microphone.
I do.
You're looking anxious to talk over there.
No, not anxious. I would say I would agree with Paul, and I'd say I thought the cigar was really great. The only EP cigar that I would say tops the 2009, in my opinion, is the 2010.
Oh, my God. Isn't that just the Oasis?
I think that's the best one he ever came out with. Yeah. But,
Dark Ritual.
The Dark Ritual is good, but I would put the 2010 above that. That's just my opinion. But
I would agree with your assessment of the Dark Ritual. As much as I love the inaugural, I think the Dark Ritual is my favorite. I've bought two boxes of them.
Me too.
Yeah, they're great.
I have not had the 2010, but the Dark Ritual,
great. Yeah. Phenomenal. So that might be my favorite Maduro ever.
For Stogie Santa's birthday, I gifted him a 2010 EP Carrillo, and he stated to me that it was one of the best cigars he smoked in a long time.
Excellent.
And absolutely raved about it. And I agree. I think that is E.P. Carrillo's best cigar. There was not very many of them produced.
Right.
I got one when they came into the local shop because they only got 5 to 7 boxes five boxes, and they sold immediately. And I found mine online at a retail shop that's no longer in business. And they just, every time I smoke one, it's pure bliss. I mean, it's an unbelievable explosion of flavors in that cigar. I mean, it's very complex. It's just got everything going for it.
Just setting yourself up there, but I'm not going to go there. We're going to keep it PG.
Explosion.
Mark Jr. is going to go there. Never mind.
Like fireworks, guys. Like fireworks, all right? Yes. Not like a XXX movie.
All right.
So, go ahead, Tim.
Casa Magna Domus Magnus Limitada.
Is this the new one that came out?
I believe this is the limited. This is the original.
Yeah. Okay. Because they re-released us. I got some of the...
Yes, they did.
Okay. Well, they're actually three new sizes.
Yes. Stogie Santa brought me in the back humidor, and we went searching deep.
There was no explosions back there, was it?
Well, I know you've been in that humidor, too, and there might have been, but just pants. Because I got so excited, yeah. You know, I've never tried this stick. I've heard so many people talk about it. I'm glad I finally tried it. I really enjoyed it. It was at the beginning of my cold, so flavor-wise, I couldn't quite pick out all the flavors, but some cedar spice, some cocoa, some sweetness that I couldn't quite place. Great performance. I am certainly going to revisit this stick if he still has them.
So. When they came out, I bought a box of those. I probably have smoked half of them now.
Okay.
I love them. I thought it was one of my favorite releases from last year.
It was a very unique flavor profile that I really enjoyed. And go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, no, I agree. It's unique. But on the same token, I also thought it was one of the closest to a Padron Aniversarios that I've ever smoked.
It's funny that you say that, because that actually
that did remind me of very, very unique. That cigar has a cigar profile that nothing else has.
Yeah,
this is as close to any cigar that I've ever smoked that was in that price range or in that flavor range. And one thing that I really liked about it, and the reason why I bought a box immediately, was because it was half the price.
Yeah, it's right. Very reasonably priced.
Very, very.
I don't remember what I bought. I purchased it for exactly, but it was very reasonable.
I think I spent $850 at a store that typically is about 20% more expensive than the store that we normally shop at.
NTA Ben, you've talked about the cigar before. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Oh yeah, I freaking love this cigar. This cigar is. It was almost at one point. It was one of my top cigars of the year. It is an incredibly complex cigar, so you definitely need to go back and revisit it when you got clear sinuses, because it changes a lot. Yeah. And it's just got great flavor from beginning to the very end. I don't really nub cigars, but that one, every time I smoke it, I have to break out my little nubber so I can get everything out of that cigar. It's very unique. Y'all are right. There's nothing like that out there.
Yeah.
There's nothing. I was so happy when I saw... when Terrence Raleigh tweeted on Twitter that they're coming back, I was like, yes, thank God, because I have four left, and I was like holding them for deathbed cigars or something like that.
I was a little nervous when they said that they're going to release it, because I was afraid that it wasn't going to be consistent, but I tried the new Centurions or Centurias. I don't have the box in front of me, so I don't remember exactly what it was, but it's the smallest of the new Vitolas of them, and it was there. It was perfect. Nice. It was exactly what I remembered. It nailed it, and I will get a box of those as well.
This is the one, right?
That's the one.
The new one.
That's the one. So and I'll buy a box of those, too.
This is the new This is the new one that I'm holding up for the camera?
I'm most interested in that size, because I bought the larger of the two sizes, and I think it's the Optimus.
Optimus Prime?
There's the Optimus, and then there's the Primus. I bought the bigger of the two, so I'm really interested in getting the smaller of the two now so that I could have...
Compare.
Well, no, more so that I could have it in a different smoking environment.
It's kind of cool. The cap kind of looks like a foot, the way they did the cap.
It's a pigtail? Or?
It's like a half pigtail.
You know what it's like? It's like the 20... I'm going to go back to it. It's like the 26 that has that exact same cap on it.
Yes, yeah, it does. Yep, that's exactly what it looks like.
It's like a nipple.
Yes, it is. It's exactly like a nipple. Yep. Smells delicious.
I love the names of these cigars.
Yeah, the Latin names like that, I love it.
This is the brainchild of Terrence Raleigh. And he, if I remember right, Latin studies is what he studied in college, if I remember right. That's where all the names come from. Like the new ones is... like Centurion, and it's like Centurius or something. The next was Praetorian, which, if you know Roman army rank structure, that's kind of what it is. Centurions were like the sergeants, and the Praetorians was like the secret service for the Caesars. And I forgot what the other name is.
Oh, good, I got some.
It's something just like that, though. I really, as a history buff, that's really cool. See that on those cigars.
Yeah, I agree.
I smoked the first one. I thought it was good. It was a time when. I was smoking, it was the week where we smoked like a ridiculous amount of cigars to try and come up with our best top 10 list for the year, and I thought it was good, but I kind of overlooked it.
I was actually shocked that it didn't show up on, I might be mistaken, but I don't remember being on anyone's top 10 list.
That's not true. It was actually on a few people's top 10, and I remember.
Yeah, it made some honorable mentions, I remember.
Yeah,
I
saw Ben, honorable mentions, but I didn't see a lot in the top 10.
It was
which
one of my like honorable mentions, I think.
And easily made one of my top tens for 2011.
It's definitely one I suggest that our listeners revisit, and one that I'm going to definitely revisit.
If I had smoked it last year, it would have been on my top 10, I think.
There you go.
It really would have. But
yeah, it was one of my runner-ups, because I had five cigars that constantly went back and forth between, cigar of the year and got knocked out. There was something else, and it was runner-up on my list.
For those who have never done a top 10 list, it is a tough thing to do, man, if you are.
Oh, yeah.
It really, I think it is, but anyways, moving on.
Cabaguan Guapo's RX. This is a...
Yeah, dude, I want to hear about it, because the one I gave you didn't draw or burned right.
No. So the first attempt at smoking one of these did not draw at all. It was awful construction. However, this one, I bought another one, because the one you gave me, I actually lit up, and I tried to smoke it, and... It didn't work, but I could tell that there were flavors there.
Yeah.
So I bought another one, and this was a solid smoke, great construction, classic Tatawahe flavors, spice wood, a great finish on the palate, and a great finish on the cigar. The cigar was great from start to finish. It's not an over-the-top awesome cigar.
No, it's not.
However, it's one that you can smoke and not really have to pay a lot of attention to. You get the nice flavors throughout. I forget how you described it to me. An easy smoke. That's what you say. It's a nice, easy, smooth
smoke. Smooth yeah. smoke. I like the Robusto.
Well, this was the Guapo's RX, which is
slightly larger, I believe.
It's a it's like a yeah. big Robusto. Yeah. Slightly longer, slightly larger ring gauge than a traditional Robusto.
I enjoy the I enjoy the stick at lunch, to be honest
yeah.
with you.
Yeah, I can see this being a good, nice lunch cigar. I say it's at least go get a 5-pack or even a box if you can get one cheap. So my rating here is kind of weird.
No, it's a valid point because our ratings don't take into account price.
Price, right.
And I'll tell you right now that
if you can get them on closeout, I think you buy a box of these.
Big Al and I ended up getting one on auction for, yeah. you know, 40% off MSRP. And at that price, it worked out to right. be $5, $6 right. a stick, which is a steal. I mean,
I'm not sure if I have the stats on this particular cigar. Oh, I do. You ready for this?
Go for it.
This is Ecuadorian Connecticut sun-grown wrapper, a Nicaraguan binder, and filler. Not sure what the MSRP is. I don't have that in my notes, but I do.
It's somewhere in the $9 range.
Yeah. Yeah, and MSRP at $9. I don't know if I'd pay $9 for this. I think your $9 is spent better spent on a different cigar. Yeah. But if you can get those at 40% off, grab at least a 5-pack, if not a box.
Yeah, I agree. Anybody else smoke the cigar? Or?
Guapo's RX, anyone?
I've smoked most of the Cabaguan series. I think if... I had recommended this to my brother's...
Yeah, you were saying this. So there was a wedding or something?
My
yeah.
brother's friend, his friend was getting married, and he had called me up and wanted to know what type of cigars they wanted to smoke cigars on the bachelor party. And nothing but, you know, it was a bunch of novice cigar smokers, but they wanted to enjoy a cigar with regardless of what they were doing. But they wanted to have a cigar, and, you know, they had a little extra, you know, he wanted to spend a little extra money on it. And actually went on one of the auction sites and found him a good deal. I think it was around, he paid $7 for the stick. And I thought that was, I think the Cabaguan series is a good cigar for a novice cigar smoker who wants to start stepping up a little bit.
Yeah, I agree with that.
sorry, I was just choking. I'm good.
You want me to go on to my next one while you?
Yeah, please do.
Okay. Somebody give him the Heimlich and I'll move on. So this is a unique one, actually, Habano. I got this in a trade. I only got one. I'm kind of bummed I only got one. I'm having trouble finding more. But it was the La Gloria Cubana Madeidor number 4 from south of Miami. Very unique size. It was a 32x6. I'm not sure what you call that.
I think you call it a 32x6.
Yeah. Unique flavor profile, too.
Or even a 6x32.
6x32, that works too. Wow, getting fancy now. two words, lemon pepper. This thing was a citrus pepper bomb. Very unique profile. Did not change up a whole lot, but a nice change of pace. It was smooth. It burned perfectly. It drew perfectly. Under 30-minute smoke because of the size. I kind of came up with my own unique rating for it. I only smoked one. I say box split. I'm not sure I'd want a whole box of these things, but I could see myself smoking one.
Change
of these
your pace kind of thing.
Once in a while, yeah. Very nice. Very enjoyable. If you could find them. But we'll see.
So this next cigar that I smoked, I want to kind of set the stage for it. I was poking around in the case at our local cigar shop, as I like to do. And I like to try and find things that people may have overlooked, kind of the sleepers of the store, so to speak, that are available in the case that everyone can see, but a lot of people may overlook. And I decided, I found one, and the scent off of the foot and the wrapper was just heavenly. It was unbelievable, the scents and flavors that you got just by sniffing the cigar. So I was super excited to smoke it. And I wanted to smoke it on a fresh palate. I was all excited. So I lit it up at 11 o'clock in the morning. Not a good idea. I don't recommend that you do that with a
Paul. Know what you're talking about? Yeah, that's not a good idea.
A Paul Gamarian Gourmet Series Symphony 20, the original release in the Toro size.
That's the connoisseur, or is that?
No, this is the Symphony. Gourmet Series Symphony.
Okay, okay. Yeah, I'm getting confused with the Symphony 20.
This is a Gourmet Series Symphony. I don't have any other information on it as far as wrapper binder, but it is still very strong. So this is the one that he came out with. It was a special release.
Okay.
It was an Toro size. Phenomenal cigar. Then he came out with the Robusto and the Salamone.
Yes.
About a year and a half or so later, two of which are some of my most favorite cigars.
I believe it's
called
the Connoisseur.
The Connoisseur. Yeah. Sorry. This is the Connoisseur series. Yes. So, it like I said, it smelled off and it smoked great. The flavors were outstanding, and it packs a punch. Not, I mean, nicotine strength. It is pretty strong, yes. But I mean, it's full flavored, full bodied smoke. Which can kind of overwhelm you at before you've had lunch. So I definitely recommend you get at least a breakfast and a lunch in before you go.
I'm going to recommend a dinner, to be quite honest.
Maybe even a dinner.
You. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, just to do the flavors justice. I mean, because it was overwhelming. Having said that, it was an awesome, awesome smoke. Yeah. It was really, really good. Tons of flavor, full of flavor. I think it's still got a ton of aging potential left in it.
Oh yeah,
and I think it's one of the sleepers. I think a lot of people reach for the Robusto or the Salamone. The original Toro size really packs that punch. Now, having said that, you switch to the Salamone size.
Yep.
It's not as in your face flavors. The flavors are still there. They're slightly subdued, maybe due to the larger ring gauge size. The Vitola of the Salamone.
That's a big,
it tends explode. To balance out those flavors. I still think the Salamone, for me, is my favorite size in that series, and actually one of my favorite Salamones of all time.
I go with the Robusto only because I'm a wuss on the strength, but they're all good.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what.
The Robusto really concentrates a lot of that flavor in there, though, and it definitely, all three sizes are very, very different.
Yeah.
As far as presenting the flavors to your palate, I think.
I'll tell you what, when Stogie Santa pulled out one of those Toros out of the case a couple weeks ago, it had some of the most oils I've ever seen coming out of the wrapper.
It's a much darker wrapper.
It was slick, yes. And it was darker than the other two sizes. Yes. I couldn't believe the difference, but
there's definitely some different tobaccos going on in that smoke. I mean, you can just visually see by the wrapper.
Yeah. Mark Jr.?
I loved it. I am new to the Paul Grammarian line. I've never really frequented a shop that had them before I started going to this shop, and they are across the board a very awesome line of cigars.
Yeah, all his smokes are just awesome.
They seem to stack on top of each other. Every time I try a new one, I'm like, oh my God, I love it. I love it. I love it more than this one. I love it more than that one. But that was an exceptional smoking experience.
It's not a very, unfortunately, it's not the most popular brand.
No, it's not.
Right?
It's pricey.
It is pricey. He does limit somewhat his availability his prices. Yeah. Rhode Island Ben.
Yep. Talking about price, though, like how much is that cigar again? It's in the $16, $19 range?
It's around $16,
Yeah.
Yep. Well,
Salamone's like $18.
Right.
And Robusto's less, yeah.
I had smoked it when it first came out, and a lot of cigar makers now I find they're trying to come up with that upscale cigar, that cigar that's over $16, competing a little bit with Padron, and I think a lot of them fall short.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I think most of them fall short.
I agree.
But I find that the Paul Grammarian Symphony did not fall short. That I would have a hard time choosing between some of the Padrone Impresarios and that Paul Grammarian Symphony. So I thought that that's kind of what puts it by itself, differentiates it from other cigars in that price category.
Mm. Now, NTA Ben, I know you're getting on a PG kick as of late. You have something to add, or?
Well, the only ones that I've had is just the regular Gourmet series, and I had one about my first one probably, I don't know, 3 weeks ago that NTA Sean gave me, and it was really spectacular. And then a buddy of mine went over to Destin, Florida on vacation and went to Harbor Cigars, which carries Paul Grammarian, but all he had was the Gourmet and the Gourmet Maduro. He brought me back one each of those, and I smoked that Gourmet yesterday, as a matter of fact. It was amazing.
Nice.
But it happened while I was at the shop. I was actually smoking it, our local shop, the cigar shop in Biloxi, Mississippi. And they, it just happened that one of the guys there, Mike, that works there, was like, hey, I think we just got a sampler of those sent in. And as it went, looked at his little humidor or whatever, says, yeah, sure enough. And he pulled out a Symphony 20 Robusto.
Nice.
I'm like, ooh, you want to trade? So I was able to work out something. I got that one, but I haven't smoked it just yet.
Yeah, those are really good.
Full meal, my friend. Full meal.
Yeah.
They're awesome, though.
I know we've gone this way a lot on this show, but those Reserva Exclusivas.
It's on my list this board. Week. Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, Dylan. Let's talk about it while we're on the topic.
Well, Mock Jr. and I cleaned out a online retailer this week of the last of the Paul Gamarian Reserva Exclusiva Corona.
One of the larger online retailers, too, yes. Atlantic Cigar.
Yeah. I think they had 2 5-packs left where you each bought one each.
Without knowing.
Without knowing.
We just kind of happened that way.
And, yeah, they're good.
They were a ridiculously awesome price for them, too, I thought.
Yeah, they were reasonably priced. Was it 40... for a 5-pack? I was 42 for a 5-pack.
A while back, I joined the site so I could have access to the Wolfmans when they came out.
Uh-huh.
I got mine. You're going to be pissed. I got mine for $31.99.
Oh, wow. That's good price. I can't be pissed at you for that, man. You're just smarter than me. That's all.
Yeah.
Mad at that. Ben, NTA Ben, I know you want to try one of these. It's in the mail, man. I sent you one. So let it rest, though, dude. Because I was out sick, so it sat on my desk at work for about 3 days in the package. So definitely let it rest for about a week.
Well, if it's coming through Mississippi and Alabama and all that through the mail, it's probably going to get well humidified on the way.
Yeah, I definitely, the one I smoked this week, I had some wrapper issues with cracking and stuff, but I can't hold it against the cigar. It sat on my desk for three or four days. So it's a solid smoke.
Yep.
Not, you know, I would like to know.
This is the Corona size you're speaking of.
It's a Corona Extra, yeah.
And there's also, they also make almost like a Lancero. That's the Grand Panatella.
Yes.
And this is not the Coronas that Mark had.
Oh, this is different.
This is different.
These are larger.
Oh, Corona Extra.
Yeah, they are substantially bigger ring gauge.
Now, Paul, you and I had bought a box
of the
Coronas back in December. I believe they are 7 years old. Mm-hmm. I have a couple left, and try not to smoke them, but I will.
Also, the Grand Panatellas are similar age.
Fantastic, too.
I go back and forth of which one I like better. I think I like them equally as much.
You know, I
they're both outrageous.
Yeah. I texted Stogie Santa this week to see if he had any more, and he didn't even answer me. I think he was too busy laughing.
Yeah.
So,
I think, you know, I think that road has come to an end.
Yeah. I left it alone.
I stocked up with as many as I could finagle out of them, and then that was it.
I am curious of whether or not they're still making these sticks. I don't think they are.
Probably not.
It's a great representation of a medium-bodied smoke that can still be complex. It just, wow. Wow. That's all
and
I can say.
For those out there that want to go seek them out, Reserva Exclusiva.
Yes.
Paul Gamarian series. Yeah. In pretty much any size. I've had the Robusto size as well.
Yeah.
Corona and the Lancero type size.
There's a Churchill, too.
And there's a Churchill. I haven't smoked the Churchill.
I have not.
But I tell you, everything I've smoked in this particular blend has been very special.
Yeah.
And you should definitely seek them out. I smoked an unbanded La Aurora Preferido. This was either a Maduro or a Ruby. I'm not sure exactly what it was.
Okay.
It definitely had some age on it. It was a gift from my friend Jeff. How's it going, Jeff? Jeff is a regular listener. Thank you very much for the smoke. It was awesome. A nice change ups in flavor. The classic La Aurora goodness. And in the link, I tried to catch a picture of the oils that were still oozing from the cigar as I was smoking it down in the final third. It's a sign that even though the cigar had a few years of age on it, there were still some oils left in it, which means even more aging potential. And it was a very enjoyable smoke. I really like the La Aurora. Anything in the Preferido sizes is spectacular.
Now, the Preferidos is a Perfecto, just to give everybody
a... Yes, Perfecto size.
Yep. And I'll tell you what, La Aurora knows how to make a Perfecto.
They do.
I smoked one tonight, and that thing held a 2-inch ash.
In fact, on our Facebook page, we got a lot of responses to the picture of the box. Sun-grown Maduro, right?
Yep. That's what the box says, yes.
Yeah, Mark Jr. came in with one. I bought a couple. I've talked about the gift pack that I got that had some age on it. I love the ones that say Maduro on the wrapper, especially the Preferido size. I've got the regular Robustos that say Maduro on the wrapper. Those are good.
I got to be honest, man. I like the ones that say Maduro on the wrapper better than the rubies.
Yes, the rubies are the ones that
and
come
in
that.
And the rubies are more expensive.
Yeah, and that's a shiny red tube.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Smoked one tonight, actually, out of the new box that just came in. So.
NTA Ben, have you smoked any Preferidos that really stick out in your brain?
Yeah. I was just thinking about that. The best, y'all right, the best I've ever had are the La Auroras. I mean, because I think they've actually perfected that. I mean, it's amazing. Probably the best I've ever had was a really old Cien Años, one that they gave us down there while we were at the La Aurora factory visiting the Dominican Republic.
Nice.
That was spectacular. I think it was 8 or 9 years old or something like that.
What was the size profile on that?
It was probably about, I don't know, maybe 6. I'm holding my hands up like you can see me.
We can see you. Video can see you.
Maybe a 6x54 ring gauge or something like that. It was a pretty substantial size.
So it was a Perfecto, though.
Was it a Preferido size or was it a Torpedo?
No, it was a Preferido size.
Nice.
It was the largest Preferido size, sounds like. Yeah.
Yes.
That I tell you what, that the largest Preferido
That's
size,
the
I believe,
number
is
one.
It's like a 6x54?
Yes, it's the number one.
Yeah.
In the Cameroon and the Maduro is, and the Cien Años, well, the Cien Años we got were a little smaller than that recently, Mark Jr. Those are
fives, I think, really, weren't they?
Yeah.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I believe
they're actually a one.
They could
Preferido
be a
one size.
Yeah. So I've got the Cameroons, and I've had a Maduro in that largest size, or pretty close to it, and they're awesome. They're awesome.
I think my favorite of the entire line is probably the Ecuadorian one. I can't
really?
Get
those. Really?
Yeah.
I've got some of those. I have to go back and smoke some.
I have not had one.
Is
of
that
those.
The platinum?
No, that's the
green.
The
Emerald.
Oh,
yes.
I reviewed that, actually. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's smoke. Me is just, I always go back to that one. It's my favorite. Matter of fact, we were actually took a trip to, Puerto Playa, which is like their beach resort area, just to kind of hang out one day. And Guillermo Leon actually brought out 2 boxes of those for all of us to smoke, just because I talk so much about how good that cigar is.
Nice.
It's just spectacular smoke. I love it. It's bad. Even in the Robusto size, the Preferido blend, it's just great, outstanding smoke. And the Robusto, actually, to me, really, it smokes better than the Preferidos ones. It actually has a little bit better flavor, I guess, because of the format. Mm. And it's way cheaper. It's $5 cheaper.
You know, it's funny that you say that, because the Maduro, my favorite is the Robusto in the Maduro.
Yeah.
I just think the flavor is more concentrated. I mean, I love the Perfecto, but the Robusto, for whatever reason,
it's good stuff.
Really does it for me.
So let's go around and see how everyone's Oliva Serie V Maduro Especiales are doing. Tim?
I'm nubbing it, man. I'm down to about the last inch.
And you're 2011.
I am the 2010.
2010.
You're smoking the 2011.
I'm smoking the 2011.
Have some more rum.
See? I knew as we drank on the show that things were going to get really confusing.
I got to be honest, man. This last third, I think, is my favorite pot of the smoke. It's definitely getting, as it's tapering down, more concentration of the flavors. I'm really digging it. It's staying cool. It's drawing perfectly. It's not hot. I mean,
I enjoyed the final third of that.
Yeah,
as well.
It's really absolutely. It's good.
Rhode Island Ben, how you doing? I saw you just pitched yours in the ashtray.
Right. It went out about I would say about 10 minutes ago. Had still a little bit of a burn issue, but it was good. So I would say overall, I would say that's a really great cigar. It got a little sweeter at the end. But like I said, it went out, so I don't know if I got all the flavors. Regardless of that last, it wasn't even a third. It was the last a fifth of the cigar. Very good cigar, in my opinion.
Mark Jr.
The end of mine went to hell, actually. The burn got awful. It got really hot and bitter.
Really?
It was a disappointing end to a really good cigar.
Well, it looked like it was canoeing on you there for a while.
Yeah, pretty substantially, actually. No, it's not the one.
Yeah.
Let's play dig through the ashtray and find what.
The burn went to hell. The I, I it It was a disappointing end to a really good cigar, to be honest with you. I was really enjoying it until that last inch.
It's interesting you say that.
But who? I mean, it's the last inch. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. The cigar's done.
Yeah.
I'm in the final third of the 2011, and it's a little harsh. It's a little bitter. Not as good as the first two thirds by any stretch. I got a nice coffee espresso flavor. Nice spice in the first two thirds, and that's kind of dissipating now, getting a little not as enjoyable in the final third, I'm finding.
You made it further through that than I did through mine last night.
Did you have the same experience in the 2011 in the final third?
Yeah, I made it less, like I said, I made it probably to the end of your ash there, and I just
chucked it.
Went to bed.
Yeah.
I can see that. NTA Ben, how you doing over there, buddy? 2009.
Man, this thing is awesome. Just like what Tim said with his, this it's getting better and better and better as it burns down. This right now, the flavors are the same, but it's just like what Tim said with his. They're more concentrated now. Mm. The further it burns, the more flavors. It's great. It's getting better and better as it burns now. I love this stick.
Very nice. So let's see, I've got a Cusano 18. This was a kind of a Corona Gorda type size. And it's an okay medium body cigar. No real change-ups, just okay flavors. My suggestion is to maybe buy one to try. A friend of mine suggested these to me.
Those are no longer in production, correct?
I'm not sure. Well, Cusano got bought out by Davidoff.
Yeah, and then they formed CNC.
Yes.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but...
Well, one of the owners, he sold it to Davidoff, then he went off and made another company, which is CNC.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Which is good.
Yeah.
They're good $4 smokes, man.
They sent us some sticks, yeah.
Yeah, they did. Yeah.
They're solid. Jose L. Piedra Conservasis. This is a budget Cuban. I believe, from what I've read, and I've been doing a lot of research on these cigars because I thoroughly enjoyed it. I believe the story goes that the new ones being produced now are a machine-made, I said machine-made on the show, just noting that.
Bite your tongue.
I know. It's a machine-made binder and filler, and it's a short mix of short filler and long filler. It's a short filler, completely short filler inside, and machine-made the filler and binder.
Okay.
Okay? So they crank it on the machine, then they put a hand wrapper applied to it. They're $2 to $3 a stick, and it had fantastic, great Cuban flavors, and very enjoyable.
Interesting.
I was impressed. So, NTA Ben, you've smoked these before?
Yeah, I've had a couple of them, matter of fact, and I actually thought, for what they are, they're really good.
Mm. Now, can you find those anywhere? I mean, they...
Yeah, you buy them in bundles, and there are some sites available on the internet that I did find them. About $50 for 25, Ben, is that correct?
I believe so, yeah. They're not very expensive.
Yeah, it's a great budget Cuban. I tell you, it presented, again, those classic Cuban flavors in a short filler cigar.
Wow.
Primarily machine-made. And
there's nothing wrong with a short filler. It's just not going to hold an ash.
I mean, it's the machine-made that's kind of weird. Like, every cigar we talk about in the show, I would say 99.9% of the time is handmade.
Yeah, well.
From start to finish. This one is machine made, and I tell you what, though, I mean, that saves them a ton of money in processing, right? And they passing on that savings to you when you buy them.
Yep.
And for $2 or $3, I mean, go out and buy 25. And you have to let these rest. That's the other thing. I was reading on some of the forums where people had bought these, and if you smoke them when they first come in,
they're very
harsh and bitter.
Yeah.
Give them 3 or 4 months rest, and they're smokable. Let them age a little longer. This was gifted to me when I was in Baltimore in March.
Nice.
And I was very thankful for that. And something that I'm going to look for and probably buy a bundle to keep in my humidor.
Very cool.
It's a really good beginner Cuban cigar.
Yeah.
For somebody who wanted to grab one just to see what it's like. You don't want to put out a whole lot of money. It's a good intro cigar.
Absolutely. I also smoked a Viaje Skull and Bones Weapon of Mass Destruction, a WMD from 2011. This had nice pepper, great flavors throughout. This is the short little torpedo.
Yep.
And it reminded me of the shotgun shells that just came out.
I could see that, yeah.
When these first came out, it was like overpowering.
Yes.
oh my God, it wasn't that great, actually, because it was just all strength.
And these are a year old now.
And no flavor. They're a year old now. Yeah. So I went back and I smoked one, and I was pleasantly surprised. I thought it was very good. It poured smoke and presented those very, very similar flavors to the shotgun shell.
These are great with a year of age. All the skull and bones except for the famous Daisy Cutter, which was immaculate just right out of the box. All of them needed about a year. And after a year, if you go back to them now, they're just great smokes now.
So it's funny that you mentioned the Daisy Cutter.
I have one. You know, I don't think that made it to the show notes.
It was there earlier. Maybe you put it up in the Stogie's feed.
Yeah, it's in the Stogie's feed. Hold on.
Tell you what, I'll talk about the next one.
Yeah, go ahead.
All right.
Go ahead.
All right. One that Paul gifted me, actually, this past weekend at the event we were at, the Bolivar Bellicosos Finos. Second Bolivar I've grabbed in the last couple weeks. Big brother to the Petit Corona. This stick performed perfectly. Slightly stronger flavors up front than the Petit Corona. As the burn line worked its way down to the tapered length of the stick, it definitely...
Ding!
Oh,
sorry. Ash just dropped on my hand.
Paul, is that a burn?
No, it landed on my hand first.
Okay.
The burn is through my skin, not my shirt.
That doesn't count. That doesn't count. You all right?
Yeah, no, I'm good. I'm good. Carry on.
All right. As it came down the narrow part of the ring gauge, it definitely reminded me of the PT Corona. Very enjoyable. I enjoyed both sizes, both box worthy. In the end, I would probably pick the Petit Corona myself.
Yeah, I love the Bellicoso Finos because I think the larger ring gauge, I think it almost balances out some of the smoke in the beginning and gives you a much more medium bodied feel to the flavors in the Bolivars. And then, like you said, as it goes down and gets a little narrower, the flavors pick up in intensity and gives you that feel of a Petit Corona.
Yeah.
So I like the Bellicoso Finos better.
And I got to thank you, Paul. This is the first stick I smoked after being sick after 6 days.
Yes.
And it was perfect, man. Yes.
This was when we were freezing our asses off.
I didn't care, man. Yeah. I had a fresh palate. I hadn't smoked in 6 days. Yeah. I had a big fat sirloin in my stomach. I was happy. So
nice.
Thank you.
So I smoked a Viaje Skull and Bones Daisy Cutter. This is the original Viaje Skull and Bones release.
Paul, you suck.
The one that, I have to thank Stogie Santa.
Yeah, big time.
I had to beg and plead with him and basically whine and cry and tell him everyone always talks about this Daisy Cutter and I've never had one and wah.
You told me that was the last one. I don't believe
him,
though.
Finally, no, he's definitely lying to you. And finally, I believe it was a Christmas or my birthday, he finally said, shut up, stop whining, here's one, just smoke it and shut up. So I finally got around to smoking it. He gave it to me, actually I was sick, you know, over the winter, and I was no way I was going anywhere near the stick when I had, you know, when I had a cold. So this is, I mean, hands down, and I want to say this is probably... This is, not even probably, this is one of the cigars that lives up to the hype. And I've talked to so many people, like the original Skull and Bones was hands down
the greatest. So what you're saying is the Oasis?
This is the Oasis, man. Crawl across the desert for this bad boy. I mean, everything...
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, there's only 150 boxes of these, man?
I believe so.
Yeah.
I believe you're correct. Right. Everything they said about this stick being amazing is true and more. And the thing that really gets me about this one is the flavor.
Yeah.
And how it just keeps pouring... These unique flavors, not so much unique, but the representation of these flavors, it's very much a coffee and chocolate flavors. But unlike a Padron, they're much more prominent. It was almost like it was coffee or chocolate infused without the overbearing sweetness that you would get from smoking one of those horrible infused cigars. And Stogie Santa, I think, very accurately described that to me and said, you know, his wife who doesn't smoke a lot of cigars loves this particular cigar.
It's a regular cigar. I have no chance in hell getting one then.
it's just an unbelievable representation of those coffee and cocoa flavors, and it's the bomb. It's the bomb.
Nice.
Oh wait, maybe I do have more information about it. Here it is. Hold on.
What size is that? Is that a longer?
I can give. I can. I can give you that. Ready?
Yep.
The Skull and Bones lines is only available in the first release in a 4x54 okay. Vitola. It's wrapped in a sun-grown Criollo wrapper containing Nicaraguan binder and filler. They come in 25 a box and retail for only $9 a stick, and I would pay $9 all day long for this. Yeah. Only 150 boxes were produced and adorned in, you guessed it, the Skull and Bones crossbones on the front of it. And the box reads, "Be warned," and I got this from the BOTL forum.
And I believe the band on that cigar is dead set in the middle of the cigar, correct?
Yes, that is correct. You know, for a non-Cuban... So to compare it to cigars that have poured flavor, Cubans with age, the vintage cigars have poured flavor. This is the first like Nicaraguan type cigar that has poured flavor in this manner, even hands and above, more intense than a Padron or on that level.
Really?
Of pouring flavor.
That's impressive.
Yeah, which is why I understand why Stogie Santa loves them so much.
Yeah.
Because he's a big Padron fan. So.
Yes, he is.
Yeah, great cigar. Great cigar.
I would take it over any Padron.
Have you smoked the original one, Ben?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, several.
Yeah. Would you agree with my assessment of being Padron flavors, but more intense even?
Definitely. Definitely. There's not much I would take over one of these.
Yeah, I agree. Fantastic flavors.
I have one left.
Go ahead,
I've
Tim.
Go ahead,
Mark
I've
Jr.
I've never had one. It's, you know.
You have to whine and cry to Stogie Santa.
You and I
months.
Can go sit in the corner in the pity potty club and cry.
Please, Stogie Santa, give me one, please.
Yeah, man, it's.
You should beg
on the short list of.
That's on there. Yeah.
I'd pretty much do anything.
I mean, it was so good that even though he gave me one, and my chances of getting another one are slim to none, I would still beg for another one.
Yeah,
yeah, that's nice. How good it is.
Pride is very overrated.
I would throw it right out the window. Right out the window. Well, I'll talk about one. You know, I have to put Opus X in my list. Usually, just to spite Tim, I put an Opus X and a Davidoff in my list.
I have no problem with Davidoff.
So I'll put the one on my list first. Okay. How's that? Opus X El Scorpion 2009. This was a major disappointment.
Yeah, I saw the picture.
Overpriced, underrated, poor construction. I mean, the wrapper on this one fell off in the last like third of the cigar, which, I mean, it's a pretty big Vitola, so the last third is significant. And I read another review that someone that smoked one of these, and they also rated this. They rated it well, however. They also stated that the wrapper fell off inside the coffin that it came in. This was from 2009. From the 22-count Opus box. The flavors were just okay. I had some issues in the beginning. There was a hole in the beginning of a void that I had to really, like, torch the snot out of it to get it to burn right. Then the flavors were just okay. Then the wrapper fell apart. I mean, it was a hot mess. And at this point, all the cigars, mostly with Mark Jr., that we've smoked before, we'll get together and smoke the rare Opus together and kind of compare and contrast notes. I don't think I'd buy another 22-count box at this point. I think I've smoked enough from the box to know that the non-production Opus is not worth the $40 a stick you pay for.
This might sound really shitty, but excuse me, excuse the profanity there, but. If I found it at a good enough price, I would take it. I would buy it. I would take the BBMFs out.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I would sell them individually and get all of my money back.
Yeah.
Because I tell you what, the BBMF Maduro that came out of this box was...
One thing about Opus, man, you could sell and trade it for whatever you want.
You can.
Yeah.
Now, I don't want to make it sound like every cigar was horrible. They're not horrible. They don't live up to the hype and they don't live up to the price tag, except for the BBMF Maduro, which exceeds... The price and hype on that. I mean, that cigar is phenomenal.
That was great. But that same day, you smoked that. I smoked that Lost City the Hemingway shape. That was really, really good. It was.
You already have one.
It had like an oaky, like wood bourbon-y type flavor to it that was a little bit. Different than most Opus X's. This one was a few years old, so it was the Forbidden Lost City Hemingway shape, and yep. it was a really, really
enjoyable. Is that like a Hemingway classic or signature type shape?
It was the length of a classic, but it was fatter.
Okay. And it was good, but not.
It was good, but I mean, they're not $30 smokes.
Yeah, to be honest.
Yeah. I got a couple off auction this year for substantially less than $30, and I'm happy to have them. But, you know, in terms of the Opus X, I agree with you in terms of the higher-end Vitolas. The BBMF was good. I enjoyed the Chili Pepper. But the other ones, eh.
I thought the Shark was good, but then kind of fizzled out
shark,
at the end.
The Añejo Shark kills the Opus X Shark.
Yeah, murders it, slaughters it, buries it.
In terms of the Opus, I like the regular Opus shapes. I like the Triple X Bellicoso. I like the Petit Lancero. I like the Super Bellicoso, the Double Robusto. Those really, really outperform the Special Vitolas, and they're substantially less money.
NTA Ben, your assessment on some of the rare Opus you might have smoked in your lifetime.
Did we lose him?
I think he's muted.
Can't hear you again, Ben.
Damn technology.
Hey, is there an IT guy in the house? Oh, wait a second.
Ouch. That sucked. Well, I was saying was, actually, that's one thing I haven't had, is I've had almost none of the rare Opus X. I've never really been that big of an Opus X fan, and really, the fanboyism has kind of turned me off to them, to be honest. And the only one that I have is the Chili Pepper that Mark sent me, and I'm going to smoke that on my birthday this year. So that actually will be the first one. Other than that, I stick to the regular Opus lines with several years of age on them, especially like the Power Ranger. That's probably my favorite.
Amen.
Funny you should say that. I smoked an Opus X Super Bellicoso, a.k.a. the Power Ranger. Found it to be, and this one had some age on it from Mark Jr.
That's a different size than the Super Bellicoso, actually.
Is it really?
The Super Bellicoso is a bigger Bellicoso.
But I've seen the
It's the Bellicoso Triple X.
Triple X, yes. So it's a Super, so Super shouldn't be in there.
Should not.
It's an Opus X Bellicoso Triple X, a.k.a. Power Ranger.
Correct.
Thank you for that. So the one Mark Jr. gave me had a lot of age on it. I don't know. It was crystally plume all over it.
Yeah, it's 06 or 07 or something.
There was an awesome start, phenomenal, a boring middle, and an awesome finish. I mean, that's my honest assessment.
Yeah, I disagree. I will.
Maybe I missed something in the middle.
I'll buy hundreds of those and keep them and age them.
I would put it up there as one of my favorite sizes. Like I said, sometimes they go flat on me.
It's between that and the Petit Lancero for me for my two favorite Opus.
I'm going to add my 2 cents.
You can keep it to yourself over there.
Yeah. Keep it down over there.
I'll agree with NTA Ben in the sense that the fanboy really is a put off on those cigars. But I say to hell with having, you know, being put off by that. An aged Opus X is a phenomenal cigar, in my opinion.
I would agree. Yeah, the Power Ranger was really, really good.
But if you smoke a new one, you're wasting it.
Yeah, absolutely.
In my opinion, if you buy one from a new box and smoke it right away, you're wasting it.
Yeah.
I totally agree with that. I mean, the best Opus I've ever had was a 5-year-old Bellicoso, and it was just amazing. I had it on my vacation. My wife got a trip for me on my birthday last year, and I went to the Diamond Crown Lounge in Orange Beach, Alabama, and they sat out there on the wharf and smoked one with some Macallan 18. And it was absolutely one of the most amazing cigars I've ever had. It was that good.
Nice. Just moving on. Tim, are you done with your list?
I got one left.
Okay, go ahead.
First, I got to say thank you to Rhode Island Ben, who just handed me one of the original Padilla 1932 Robustos, which is...
spectacular.
Probably one of my all-time favorites. let's put it this way. I just handed him two Cubans, so as a thank you. Which is awesome. Anyways, moving on. Last one on my list, the Romeo and Julieta Short Churchill Tubo. Actually, formally reviewed this cigar this week. It was a little tough to write up the review. I only had two, which I smoked both. First one performed perfectly. Second one, I had a big, fat void after about the first half inch or so. Clipped it, continued smoking it because I was enjoying the flavors so much. Nice medium-bodied smoke, toasty. I got a lot of coffee, some graham cracker sweetness. I really, really like the smoke. Tough to formally rate it, but I was willing to take a chance on it. Ordered a box this week, so I'm going with box worthy. I will report in the future weeks on how the newer ones are smoking. So, good stuff. Anybody else have these before? NTA Ben, maybe?
Which cigar was that again?
The Romeo and Julieta Short Churchill?
No, that's on my short list of ones I want to try. I've heard really good things about it.
I really enjoyed it.
I have. I do like it a lot. I agreed with your review. I read it this week about the non-traditional Cuban flavor to it.
Very much so.
But I would typically say that about all Romeo and Julietas, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
They are a different Cuban cigar. Yeah. It's my second favorite Romeo and Julieta to okay. the they made a limited edition in 2007 called the Escudos.
Okay.
If you've never had one, I've got a few more of them. I've given a couple to Paul and he has bad luck, so
yeah.
I think I gave him two or three of them and they were all
plugged, yeah.
Yeah, weird. He got all of my plugged ones out of my box, so...
Yeah, I'll weed them out for you. That's what I do.
Yeah, it's good for you.
Free of charge.
But yeah, no, it's a...
You're a helper and a giver, Paul. Man. That's right. You're a buddy.
Romeo and Juliet is not my favorite Cuban brand.
Okay.
But I enjoyed it. I probably wouldn't buy... I wouldn't go out of my way to buy them, but I would... If it was included in a trade, I'd be happy about it. If that's fair to say about it.
I'm hoping I don't have any construction issues with the new ones. But flavor-wise, I enjoyed it. It's not the strongest Cuban I've had. Again, there's no Cuban twang, citrus, or some of those typical earthy flavors you might get. But I enjoyed it. We'll see. I'll report back in a couple weeks.
Let me know. I have a couple more left. If I make it to it, you know.
Yeah.
That's how I feel about it. It's
you want to hear about my fish in quesada?
Yes.
It's my fish in quesada. It wasn't a trouser trout, Tim. I hate to disappoint you there.
If you use the quesada for bait, I'm going to have to get you.
I could have used that. You know, I didn't go smoke through the last third because it wasn't me. It's not a great cigar. It's not horrible. I think in this size, it was a 60 ring. It was a quesada tribute. It'd be much better in a Corona. I did smoke, though, right after that one, a Gurkha Cellar Reserve, which I thought was totally awesome. Great flavors, great burning construction, which helped while I was fishing. But I liked the Cellar Reserve a lot. Now, you told me that the four Cellar Reserves that you had...
All were tight draws.
All were tight draws. This one smoked beautifully, and I really liked the flavors, and I thought it was really cool. There's 15-year-old tobacco.
Yes, there is.
In the Cellar Reserves. Yep. So I liked the Cellar Reserve. I had one that drew well. I can totally see. I get you when you talk about the bad draw, because you know me. If it's a bad draw, I pitch it and move on to the next one.
I force my
four of them though. That's impressive.
Yeah, I mean, it is what it is. Who knows?
Yeah.
I mean, maybe it was just humidity in my humidor, or you know, bad luck.
To have four. That's weird.
But
you know the background of that cigar, the story about that, why they made that.
Yeah. What was that?
It was.
I know it's a brick and mortar only release, correct?
Yeah, they made that. It was. I'm trying to remember who blended it. It was one of the quesadas, obviously. But I was several years back. One of the uncles and two of his sons died in a plane crash. I think it was in the Dominican Republic, and they made this as a tribute to them. Is what it was for. Nice. I personally have never really. I've had like three or four of them. I didn't really care for them that much, which was a lot of the original quesadas I don't really care for. I kind of was standoffish with the new ones, like the new stuff coming out, like the Oktoberfest, the Molotov cocktail.
Yeah, the new stuff is awesome. Yeah,
but the new stuff is spectacular. But that one I'd say it was hit and miss. I had a petite Corona, which I really liked, but the larger ones I didn't really care for too much.
Interesting. The last one here on my list, is the I almost saved the best for last. This, I mean, aside from the 1998 Hoyo, this has to be the best one that I've smoked in a while. This is the La Aurora Puro Vintage 2003. A gigantic Salamone. Was just an absolutely fantastic smoke. Nice. I just couldn't get over how good this cigar was. It's a journey. When you go to set out to smoke one of these things, prepare yourself for a journey. It starts out with very mild, subtle flavors. It picks up and develops in this wonderful orange peel sweetness, moves to a kind of a earthy type flavor, fantastic finish on the palate, fantastic finish on the cigar. I mean, just outstanding burn, construction. You're in for one wild ride. Crawl across the desert to buy these bad boys.
I just bought them on auction on Cigar Bid for the most ridiculous. When I saw the price, I didn't believe it.
Yeah.
I got them for $50 shipped to my house for a box of eight.
Yeah, it's a good price.
I
would pay a lot more than that
for Cigar Bid from cigarbid.com. And I'm so excited. I haven't smoked one yet. I'm so excited to hear Paul say that about that cigar. I just lit up a 2004, and that it's really, really good. But I've heard the lofty claim that that is the best cigar La Aurora has ever made.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
From more than one place.
Wow.
That's
as of now.
To date. Let's say to date, obviously. Yeah. But
has anyone else smoked one of those yet?
Yeah, it's a great cigar. I really, really love that cigar.
Yeah, but I was amazed. Actually,
the new 107 Puro Vintage, I think I actually like it better.
The 107 what?
Puro Vintage.
Oh, really? So they make a Laura 107 Puro Vintage.
Yeah, it's not exactly out yet. It'll be out in June, but it was spectacular.
Is that a Salamone size as well?
Yes.
Is that this year's Puro Vintage? The 107, yeah.
Yeah. Guillermo Leon gave me one in Atlanta just before Christmas. It was amazing. It was really good. It's definitely the best 107 blend, which I love the Corona.
Yeah, I do too.
But I tell you what, if it's not better, it's at least as good as the Puro Vintage 2003. In my opinion, it is.
It's a very special cigar. I mean, crawl across the desert, get a box or two.
I agree.
I'm so psyched. I just got a box then. Dude, the more anybody says, psyched.
I think you're really going to like it. And from what I've read and talked to people,
it almost feels like you stole it. Now I feel like now that I stole them now
dirty?
For that price.
Good dirty,
though.
Okay.
And aside from my opinion, Ben's opinion, from what Stogie Santa has said, that people say the similar things about the 2003.
Yep.
It's a very mild start and just really progresses, gets very complex, and makes multiple change-ups. So it should really smoke one. It's an experience.
It's strange because it has an ugly band. The presentation is not all that spectacular. Yeah. The 2004 presentation is much better.
It's a good-looking Salamone, though. And I tell you, Salamones go. The Paul Gamarian's up there, and this is up there as my favorite. Absolutely.
Salamone's sexy, if you're told.
Yeah. And when they smoke great, the shape of the cigar adds to the smoking experience the flavor and complexity change-ups that you get, I think. So with that, that was a lot of talk. We're going to round it out, go around one more time, talk about Oliva V Serie Maduro Especial.
I am done.
What'd you think?
Nubbed. Excellent. We'll certainly revisit again. I say box worthy at this point. These things are smoking great.
Which one's your favorite?
Oh, still the 2009.
2009 is
absolutely
your favorite.
Yeah. I think the 2009 has a lot more complexity than the others.
Mm-hmm.
They're all good smokes.
Yeah, I agree.
But I find the 2009 changes up a little bit more than some of the others. So,
Rhode Island Ben. Pass the microphone over to Rhode Island Ben.
Well, I had finished my 2008 a little bit ago. Like I said, I thought it was a very good cigar. It was just that last piece, but I'll agree with Junior Mark here. That it's the end. The cigar's done. So overall,
which one have you smoked? All four?
I have not. I've only smoked the 2008 twice, and I think I smoked the 2011.
Gotcha.
Once. The 2011 was not memorable though.
Yeah, but you like the 2008.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Definitely. Mark Jr. 2008.
It was a really, really good cigar for the first It was 6.5 inches, right?
Correct.
So for the first 5.5 inches, it was awesome. The last inch was fizzled not down,
yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
It was the opposite of awesome.
Which is your favorite one, you think?
Which would be sucked I came for into those this, people who don't know.
Yeah. I came into this saying earlier that I would have had a hard time choosing between the 2008 and the 2009. But as with a lot of things in life, your latest experience will judge your experiences forward.
Yep.
After that, I mean, I had to say the 2009, I had none of that. The finish of the cigar
was
phenomenal. I'm going to go with Tim. I'm going to go with Tim. I've had all four. The 2011 being my least favorite. 2009 being my most favorite.
Nice. My 2011 was good. The finish was not so great. I have to, you know, agree on with a lot of people that smoke these. The finish was just kind of eh.
It's off.
Yeah, it's a little off.
Yeah.
Maybe age will solve that. I have to say, if I had to pick a favorite, I say it's the 2008 because of that toasted, roasted nuts flavor that you get in the beginning. I really like that flavor, so that's what I'm going with. NTA Ben.
Well, sorry, I was furiously clicking on the cigar bin right now.
Yeah.
Well, I'll hold it up for new stream viewers. This is, I'm at the very end. I'm trying to nub this thing now as far as I can. This is an excellent cigar. It's actually lost pretty much any hint of sweetness it has. It's just really spicy with that espresso note in there, and that's pretty much all that's left, but it is still really, really good. Even with that, though, I still think 2008 is my favorite, though. This is like 1A, though. I mean, it's really close to it, but it's spectacular smoke.
Nice. I would say I agree with you. 8 being my favorite, and the 10 probably being I think with a little more age, definitely.
Is getting better and better.
It is, and it's got that great coffee espresso flavor as Ben described. So, very nice. We will we'll round out this segment. We'll take a little break. When we come back, we'll talk about some of the cigars we just lit up, and move on into our Stogie Tech segment on travel humidors.